You're welcome, Stiles.
Okay. Okay, welcome to the San Mateo County Coastline Desirable Community Meeting. The Desirable Community as established as zoning regulations is appointed by Board Supervisors. Today is Thursday, July 13th, 2023, and now is 1:38 PM. This hearing consists of one project only. For better recording quality and the orderliness of the meeting, please put your phone on silence, avoid extra chatting and or whispering in the audience, and wait for my prompt before you speak on any matters. This meeting is being audio recorded. There are two opportunities for public to speak, including the oral communications for matter not on the agenda and a separate public comment session for each project on the agenda. Please review the agenda to identify which item you wish to speak on and the time of that item. For fairness and orderliness of this meeting, and due to the amount of speakers, please limit your speech to 3 minutes or less. And now this will be strictly enforced. And you'll be respectfully to ask to stop speaking after 3 minutes. The chair will open the public comment session during the public comment period for oral communications for matters not on the agenda and for each item on the regular agenda. I'll first read comments received before the meeting into the record for those who are not present in this meeting. For those attending this meeting in person, speaker forms are available on table in the rear of this room. Please fill out a speaker form and provide it to me before each public comment sessions. For those on Zoom, please use the raise hand feature to raise your hand to speak on an agenda item. For those joining by phone, please press *9 to indicate your desire to speak. Please provide your speaker phone, raise your hand, or press *9 on your phone before each public comment session. And late speaker requests will not be accepted. Please note that members of the public must wait for my prompt in connection with each agenda item before speaking. Also, you cannot speak on an agenda item that's later in this meeting. When you hear your name or last 4 digits of your phone number called, I will prompt you to come up to the front or unmute your account, then inform that you may begin speaking. I will then ask you to state your name for the record. For those joining by phone, pressing *6 will mute or unmute your microphone. The Desirable Community's decision for item one today, if any, will only be a recommendation regarding the project compliance and not the final decision on the project, the decision of which will take place at a later date. The CDRC does not review matters related to zoning standards, local coastal policies, and general plan. It will only review projects based on the design review standards and guidelines. For example, concerns regarding a possible impact on the environment or parking compliance would not be addressing this meeting. The CDRC will only review the design and architectural aspects of the project based on design review standards and guidelines. Depending on scale and scope of changes, continued projects may be placed on the next month's agenda if a revision is submitted to the county by the end of business day, August 18, 2023. Applicants should note that continuous letter may not be available by that date and are encouraged to take note of the committee's feedback. The next Coastline Design Review Committee meeting will be held on Thursday, September 14th, 2023. Item one of the agenda is the roll call. Rebecca Kekin?
Here.
Beverly Garrity?
Here.
Mark Stackmeyer?
Here.
Linda Patterson? Not here. John Stepman? Not present. Mark Ding?
Here.
With that, I turn it over to the chair.
Hello, everybody, and welcome back. Here. Especially Beverly and Mark, congratulations on joining and becoming the new chair next month. Slinging you. And I was going to thank Beverly for offering to trade alternate with full time rep as long as she takes the chair.
Rumors.
Okay, so as always, I'm just going to bring up for the record the demonstration of scale and the story polls that still haven't been implemented because of planning department efficiency or lack of staff. And mostly that, and this is to Glenn and to the other planners, that it's still almost every plan that comes across still isn't representing all four sides of that of the project. In when they do a demonstration of scale using photos or
I understand what you're trying to convey. So I've experienced that issue not very often, but in the past few months.
Yeah.
So what I will do is I will go back and read the policies and also give plans a refresher and also maybe do some quality check before they submit for a review.
Okay.
So that will probably improve the situation. And so let's keep monitoring, and if we observe like any additional issues related to demonstration scale deficiencies, that now let us know, and now we will see what else we can do to further address this.
Okay, well, it's just the threat was just to send them back, so that they wouldn't be even heard that day. So, that was our result of not being able to get the story polls approved. July's hearing was held at the county supervisor's office, and room was large enough to seat all the attendees. And the only thing that I considered an issue was the interruption that happened between the two cases when 30 people walked in during, and I don't know if we'll ever experience anything like that again, but it was really disruptive to the people that were being heard at the time, and they pretty much sort of ended and walked out because they weren't fitting anywhere. Anybody else notice that?
All I noticed was the person laughing the whole time in the recording.
It's Rebecca.
No, it might have been me. I was coughing a lot.
Yeah. Oh my gosh, it might have been you. Yeah.
But she's talking,
you were wearing
she
a mask, so
yeah,
that was appropriate.
And she does it when she laughs.
Oh, okay.
Sorry, the end of the bus. Quite all right. There's really a minute in the petition. How's that petition coming? Anything changes with that, Mark?
We have 76 people signed that petition, so I'll get that original. I'll double check and see. I don't think I asked folks to sign it on Nextdoor, but just there's a link in the Nextdoor post.
Oh, there you go.
I think you signed it on the change.org.
I did, but I went through Nextdoor.
Oh, yeah, that's right.
Yeah.
So it's 76 controls.
76.
So I'll send that list over to you. I do want to make sure that, that obviously we're really respectful of people's privacy. So maybe a summary works for now.
Does anybody have a sense of how many people you think you want to achieve before we bring to
the good question? Did you?
Not really.
I thought at least 100 as a baseline.
Okay.
And then a revisit at some point, but I thought at least 100 would make mark 75 short.
I thought about, is this something that we want to necessarily post on, put in the post office and just put on bulletin boards?
The MCC website as well.
I'll follow up with Greg Diaz and see if that's something. Just by the way, based on the next door comments, it seems like there was as much support as it was against against requiring story polls. The thought against was that there's a lot of it's more bureaucratic red tape, and it's tough to develop. So this is just another barrier that we're adding to the cost of being added to the cost of development.
Yeah. So the population of the unincorporated is around 20,000 to 25,000, and if you take 10% of that, 2,000, then we're getting 0.5 at 200. So if we could
get the numbers up.
Get the numbers up to, yeah. And they may fall out the same way, but it'll just be a little more credible.
Okay, let me think about strategies. Yeah, sure. I think Greg and Victor set up this. I mean, not at the council, but maybe some one thing to think about is how the conversation is framed, because that obviously can generate as much.
Yes, feedback, yes.
Yeah. Which is not a bad thing necessarily. Mm-hmm. It's good to get everyone's thoughts come out.
Sure.
But I do like what Mark said that, you know, if there the items brought before the commission are judged or signed off by the staff on this, and it, you know, can demonstration of skill be something that does look at as completeness. So if somebody's submitting in the architectural illustrations, but not representing all the sides, et cetera, then, you know, is that something that the planning staff can look at for completeness?
Yeah, so I think that was discussed previously. So we require demonstration of scale, but our understanding is the demonstration of scale is not part of the zoning regulations. So we, yeah, so I will discuss or discuss with Camille to see what we can do to make sure this, but the current.
I think it is part of the demonstration of scale, it's part of the regulations.
No, it's a recommendation. It's not an ordinance.
It's not ordinance.
That's
so all
the
current
is just the
it's not part of the zoning regulation. So our current approach is that when we see deficiencies in their demonstration scale, we will advise the applicant that the CDRC may continue their project because of the deficiencies.
So they don't have to do anything
not,
at all?
Huh?
They can just not do anything at all?
They can choose.
It was a part of the long-term planning and it was in process by and then it was aborted. So it's at present, in its present state, it's not an ordinance recommendation. The
I thought the demonstration of scale is required when the primary is considered acceptable.
Because it says on this website that I've been declaring it.
It is required, but it's but we cannot just take a project to the CDRC because of the deficiencies, and that will be up to the CDRC. The CDRC can decide whether the project needs to be continued because of the deficiencies. So that's at
CDRC's discretion. So it's just that story polls are not required; they're recommended. Demonstration of scale is required, is what you're saying.
Demonstration of scale is required,
mm-hmm.
but planning staff. So the decision on the completeness of their demonstration of scale is at the discretion of the CDRC. So when staff sees deficiencies, we can only advise the applicant to provide additional information or make corrections, but we don't make decisions on demonstration of scale. That's at the discretion of the CDRC.
Yeah, and it was what was in process was to articulate very specifically what would be required in a demonstration scale.
But it says, on the page that all four sides are to be completely on the demonstration. So would people have to come in, or after you send everything out and it's obvious that it hasn't happened, can you terminate that hearing at that point, or do they have to come all the way in? Does the process have to be that they have to show up here first? And
we have to tell them we haven't
That's my understanding. And not if there's any deficiencies in their demonstration of scale, that now the CDRC gets to decide whether the project shall be continued.
But 10 days prior, I get it all online. I look at it, and there's only two sides shown or whatever.
Yeah,
it's
that would
obviously then understood.
So you're saying it's within our scope to make that decision about continuing that item or not.
That sounds inconsistent with other planning requirements that are specified and when they're not fulfilled, like all four sides, the project has to comply with that in particular before it gets scheduled for review.
It's not a required aspect before we can deem a company. So we can deem a project complete without getting the demonstration of scale information. So So that's the current procedure. And I know we are having some discussions and also there's a petition going on to improve the situation. But in the meantime, that now I can probably take this concern to discuss with the internal staff and see if we can have any interim plan to solve this problem. I understand what you're saying, like when you see a project, it's required demonstration of scope information is required 10 days prior to the meeting.
Right.
But on the ninth, on the test day, you see like incomplete information and not assuming Appy can refuse to provide it. So can we decide the project needs to be postponed before we have an actual meeting? So that's another concern. We need to check with our supervisors and council to get your solid answer.
Yes, and we understand that story polls are for debate, but the actual demonstration of scale doesn't sound like it's up for debate.
It's not, but it is due after the project is deemed complete, right? The project is deemed complete in order to get on the agenda, and then the demonstration of scale is only due 10 days beforehand.
Yeah, how it works is we deem a project complete, and we schedule for CDRC meeting.
Yeah.
We do our agenda. At the same time, we ask the applicant to prepare that. So we schedule CDRC meeting before we actually get the demonstration of scale. So that's an issue. Yeah, there's a timing conflict in there. And now I understand your concern. And now, yeah, again, I want to discuss with internal staff to see before we add the demonstration of scale policies as part of our zoning regulations, that now what we can do before that to make sure we follow the policies that now we don't waste the company's
time.
Yeah. So we will look into
that. It also sets up, a potential situation where the applicant comes out here and if they're given the bad news by us,
exactly.
We're not really pleased with that. But I think it sounds like we have to have the maybe we have to be willing to enforce that.
We have.
And also just again, so the current solution is, so for example, I had a project that was scheduled for CDRC about 3-4 months ago. I can't remember the exact thing. So they did not provide like all sides of their like pictures of all sides of their structure and of the story poles. So what I did at that time was like the CDRC will have the authority to continue a project because of this deficiency. So we give the disclaimer. So that's what we're doing right now. Yeah.
Okay. Yeah, sounds like a timing issue more than anything else right now.
As it was with the poles too.
Exactly.
I guess we have a lot of constraints right now. And so I will work with Camille and also maybe our legal counsel to kind of formalize this process and just keep everyone on the same page. I don't think there's much we can do about this, but we will keep everyone on the same page with the same level of information.
Okay.
Just a related question, because I like your idea that if it was deemed that we didn't have adequate demonstration of scale in advance of the hearing, that we could maybe pull it from the agenda. But I don't know if it's within the CDRC that has to determine that it's inadequate.
Yeah,
could there be something like an email chain that goes around where everyone says, yes, we find it's inadequate, or is that a Brown Act violation?
That may be, so that may be affected by Brown Act and other state laws and local policies. So I'm not an attorney, so I don't have the knowledge to answer that question. So again, I will work with our internal staff and find a solution, and I suppose to formalize the process and minimize like our current approach.
Right. It sounds like you understand all the issues.
Yeah, understood that now.
Thanks.
But this stack at the office is
at least starts from the floor.
I'll volunteer to kind of. Like I have the policy document, not the policy document, I don't know what this is about.
That's linked to.
Yeah, just about the requirements for those visual images, but I can draft like a form letter that says something to the effect of, we believe that your whatever does not mean this local language. At least,
if we have to do that online in advance, you mean?
You did kind of give some
meeting.
Warning, it maybe is in the green territory. That's not us making a decision per se, but just giving that heads up that, hey, we think this is where it's going. If you think
it's
good.
Okay.
Thank you.
So,
positions, or ask always anybody except for your own neighborhood. I don't know why exactly you're here, but we're looking for members to join this board, and I always bring it up. So
tears are everywhere. Now you're sorry.
You're the first row.
Yeah. I thought we had two more coming. I got an email that there we Mark was signing up. I knew that. And then two more. Are those people not out?
Yeah, what I heard from Camille was that one backed out, I think, around the time of that last meeting. And then the second person didn't move forward with the training. That's what Camille was. So I was the only one in the training.
Okay. Does that mean the second person is no longer signing?
I think we'll have to ask.
Okay, so
Camille, the junior planner, has she put it on the AIA website, the county's AIA website, for volunteers as well.
Yes, yeah, that mm-hmm. email came through. That was great.
Probably just as some architects as well, right? Just that such a critical position.
Sure.
And then there's been some kind of solution, but I keep waiting for the answer. I didn't know what it was.
Well, Camille said that Bayside architects are allowed to submit for me if I'm not available. They have to be 40% time living in the county, which I think is eligible. So, yeah, Camille does have a backup plan so that if I have to miss the meeting,
I did speak to Ed Love and he said he would do that as well.
Oh, that's great. Does that know that?
I didn't. I think Camille. Or did I tell you?
No, I'm not aware of that information, but I do. I do aware of the Bay Area, the Bayside Design Company architect may be covered for Rebecca when Rebecca needs to present. No, yeah,
what Rebecca has
for anybody like someone else.
So Ed Love used to be on the CDRC when it first started.
Yeah.
And that would be great.
Yeah, he's part of the coast. He still works. Well, you know.
Yeah. Would you double check?
Yeah, I'll double check, and now we'll probably circle back with the CDRC.
I'll check my emails, and she will.
Yeah.
Yeah, I will share this information with Camille first, and see what else we want to do to make this happen.
Thanks.
Okay. I'll put the public. For public discussion, anything that does pertain to the
anything, now's your chance, not project related.
Yeah, so we are not opening public comments for oral communications for matters not on agenda. For those attending this meeting in person, speaker forms are available on the rear table. And please provide me with your speaker slip immediately. For those on Zoom, please use the raise hand feature to raise your hand to speak on this agenda item. For those joining by phone, please press star 9 to indicate your desire to speak. When you hear your name or last four digits of your phone number called, I'll prompt you to come up to the front or unmute your account and inform that you may begin speaking. I will then ask you to state your name for the record. For those joining by phone, pressing star 6 will mute or unmute your microphone. As mentioned earlier in this meeting, please limit your speech to 3 minutes or less. This will be strictly enforced, and you will be respectfully asked to stop speaking after 3 minutes.
Any public comment?
I don't see any raised hands or speaker slips. So again, please provide me with your speaker slip or raise your hand. I'll provide a few more seconds in case there are any other who would like to raise their hand or submit their speaker slip. Chair, I don't see any raised hands or speaker slip. Please indicate if you would like to close public comment.
I'd like to close public comment.
Now we're at 2:03. And now we're at 2:03, and according to the agenda, and the item 1 can start.
Okay.
Oh. Well, I was gonna never handed it over before.
Yeah, Beverly Geary is going to hear this for the Montero representative.
Okay. We're going on to item one, the owner, Kehoe Properties, LLC, applicant, Sean Lopez. File number PLN 20190029. Location 8322 Cabrillo Highway, Montero. Assessor's parcel number 0360464200. Consideration of a design review recommendations for the construction of a new 5,535 square foot two-story single-family residence with an attached 644 square foot two-car garage on a 0.61 acre currently developed legal parcel associated with a hearing level CDP, coastal development permit, and GP grading permit. The project involves the demolition of the existing residence, removal of 6 significant trees and 705 cubic yards of grading, 415 cut and 290 cut fill, 290 fill. The CDRC will not render a decision, but will make a recommendation regarding the project's compliance with design review standards. A negative declaration is required per the California Environmental Quality Act, CEQA. A planning commission public hearing on the negative declaration, the CDP and GP will take place after August 10th, 2023. The project is appealable to the California Coastal Commission. Project planner, Kanoa Kelly, kkelly at smcgov.org. Is Kanoa?
Yeah, Kanoa is on there.
Hi, Kanoa. Hi, Kanoa.
Hi, everybody.
Thanks for attending. Okay, this little table, we're not using this, Mike, are we?
We are not.
We are not. Can we drop that so they can spread the plans for any presentation they may need them for?
Yeah, I'm good.
Thank you, Mark.
All right. It is architect Rebecca Kafkin, Montero, who will be doing the project recommendations.
I'm glad you're looking at
it. You present, and then we'll ask some questions. We'll open it up to the public, and then we'll have a discussion.
Perfect. My name is Sean Lopes, project architect, here with Kevin Keough, property owner, and also in collaboration with Jim Jennings on the architecture side for the project. We've been working closely with the county to put together a package that's deemed complete from the site development side. We believe that the overall aesthetic of the project creates a low impact along the coastline with the building kind of tucked up towards the front portion of the site along Cabrillo Highway, just beyond the existing Cypress Grove. As it extends out beyond the coastline, there's about 20% of the bluff line footprint that is affected by the structure of the project. The remaining sloping topography will be created with a natural California native landscape that will be put together. The home is a single story home along the front edge there that tucks along just the existing ridge line of the topography, and the southern wing of the house extends out to the bluff, creating a low slung profile that creates a walkout lower level at grade. So we're here to answer any questions you guys may have about the project.
Single story
along the front end of the property. Oh. And then as it jets out towards the bluff, there's a small portion that daylights. There's two story.
Yeah.
You want to
start? Sure. Yeah. All right. Sixth Street. are being removed, are six trees being replaced?
Per the county requirements, we have two replacement trees counted. The other trees in the northern corner of the property, some were kind of dead and dying, and therefore we're not required to have replacement trees accounted for. So we've located replacement trees shown on sheet L2.
Are you sheet screen sharing? Is that you?
That's me.
Oh, okay. Can you screen share L2?
Yeah. That's a little slow, so we'll just bear with
it. Okay, sure. I think we've all got it on our own. Yeah, anyway.
Or if you can, you may.
No, it'll be helpful for anyone.
Okay, the page number.
Yeah, L2. Yeah,
that probably does. Okay,
so.
Yeah, we're looking at L2 right now.
Right. If you scroll up a tiny bit, I see the six X'd out. I don't see where the two replacements are indicated.
Yeah, so it looks like the file that you guys have on the screen, and maybe I can go ahead and share, is not the response to our initial commentary, but I can get up to the point here. So we have a replacement cypress that'll go here in the front corner of the property to kind of take the place of the existing one that is leaning over the street and affecting some of the utility lines. And then we also have one at the end of the driveway here to kind of replace the existing leaning trees down in that corner of the property. So again, trying to locate them at places that kind of replicate the areas that where the trees were taken out.
Who's going to keep the boat in the front yard? No, just.
I think you just elected.
Actually, I think that Phillip Point would love it because they got rid of their boat that was at the entrance to Phillip Point Harbor.
And remove it, they can keep it. They might, that last one rotted. It's one of the old fishing boats from the early days.
Uh-huh. It's actually
that's all they used to fish with.
Okay. All right. Next question. Under materials and colors all the way down. Page 39 in this. Mm-hmm. Can you tell me what this is? Forgive my ignorance.
It's a flat roof membrane on top of all the structures there, which will mostly be covered.
Yes.
With the ballast material.
Okay.
So for the most part, we're trying to have a darker color on top to match the color of the building versus the kind of white membrane you typically see.
Right. Thank you. Because up on the hills, when
you're right,
you can see that. All right, and that's it for me for now. Do you have any questions?
I have a couple of clarifying questions. Can you explain to me how the project is coming through as a major revision? Was there a previous design that was approved and this is being modified?
Yeah, so
existing home is being demolished.
So previous owner had gone through a similar site development as ours. So when Kevin purchased the property, he hired our team to be the architect for the project. So therefore, we kept a lot of the same components, okay, the arborist, soils reports, all along that. So that's why it's considered a major revision.
Okay.
So it's a new project.
And had you done the previous?
We did not.
Okay.
We did not.
And then there was related to this claim, actually, I'm going to answer the other question. Page 30, there's the materials board, and that's submitted by John Maniscalco Architecture, but I didn't see that name as on the, and it, I'm just trying to figure out what the project team is. Is that another?
Correct. So John Noss, there, that was the previous architect.
That is
so
previous.
That page,
okay,
is from the previous submittal.
The previous submittal,
yeah,
but the materials are staying the same?
Yeah. No, so that should not have been
that
part of
that page should not be here.
Yeah, that was not submitted as our package. You might have gotten caught in the portal, maybe.
Okay.
On the county side.
Yeah, so pages 30 and 31 on the next page, should
sure.
those be struck,
struck
from the application?
From the rep, yes.
Okay.
Correct.
Well, that explains. Okay.
Yeah, yeah, our visualizations on, that's part of our.
Because there's the renderings.
The renderings are meant for
okay.
for that, yeah.
Let's see.
Which is page. Cover page? No,
no
where's your
their renderings are
oh,
on
there
pages
they are.
Eight,
I see
11
and
12. Got it. Okay. Another question we've already asked that one. Let's scroll through. This is not really in our purview, but I'm just curious on page 1839 A1.1. Is that full height clear glass in the showers and bathrooms 1 and 2, letting out onto pretty much the same grade.
Page 18
of 39, just the floor plan.
Yeah.
Bathrooms
yes.
1 and bathrooms 2.
Yeah, along that glass, that edge there.
And
that,
is it obscured glass or is that
obscured?
It is obscured. Okay.
It's obscured glass. Is it bird? Sensitive.
That's the showers.
Those are the showers, yeah.
Yeah.
It's like, well, that's a lot of
no,
glass
but the
showers.
Do you have the coating on all the glass facing the ocean that is for
a bird sensitive glass? You know,
there's actually
yeah.
There's different grades, you can find it. It's just they're not crashing.
Yeah, we can definitely make note of that.
Yeah, we see a lot with projects that come through here that are really
yeah.
extensive glazing. It's definitely often requested.
Absolutely, yeah. I think a lot of the glass specifications are still to come as we get through our energy reports in terms of any films or
yes.
on those.
Okay.
So on page 27, there's the first lighting spec there, the path lighting, and I just wasn't clear if that is dark sky compliant. That light looks like it.
The architect path lighting?
Yeah.
Is that considered dark sky compliant? So all exterior
yeah.
lighting?
It needs to be, yeah, I believe that it is based on the shielded and downlit.
Yeah, it just looks like it rotates, but I think it doesn't really have to be in clarifying questions. We can just put it in conditions of approval to confirm
yeah.
that all the work is dark sky compliant. And that takes some of my questions. Sorry, one other question. There is on this plan, you can see the adjacent property, the house next door. Is that who we have in the audience, or have you guys communicated with the owners of the home next door?
I'm actually on the street over on
okay.
Z, around the corner.
Okay. Just wondering if there's been any communication with that neighbor aside from the standard notification.
Yeah, we're in constant contact.
Okay.
Adjacent and crosswise.
So the on the left hand side there, it's Nancy and Tim. Yeah.
Left hand from
the
house.
The
mm-hmm.
Yes. On the right
hand
side, I've never met Amy Wagner, but I've been in touch with her over the telephone, but she doesn't reside there typically
okay.
more than
We haven't had any correspondence, right? So no.
I didn't receive any correspondence, but can Noah, since you're on the line, please confirm if you have received any last minute correspondence from the public.
No, I have not received anything yet.
Thank you for confirmation, Ken Noah.
Great. Okay, I'd like to open it up for a public comment. Is anyone commenting on this project? Are you?
Sure. No, I was actually, I think it's, I like it. I mean, I can tell you the trees are taking down on Z Cliff needs to come down, so I'm kind of really happy about that.
Before you actually answer me, could you tell us your name, tell us where you live, and then.
Okay, Deborah Robbins, 138 Z Cliff Court in Montana,
mm-hmm.
Which I guess you were calling 6th Street. So the only question that I had that I was curious about is I know it's two stories and the poles that we're seeing, is that, does it slope down? Does that slope down in the back? And then, so that's why the second story seems to be on par with
that. It's actually not a two-story building. It's a one-story building which stretches out toward the coast because the ground falls away. There's room to touch against.
If you go to page 26.
Yeah, no, I think you guys do whatever you want. So you did a really good job of designing within that area that you have. And I'm delighted that you can get rid of that.
Page 24, actually.
Can you share your screen?
Can I speak as a member of the public?
Yes, your name, location. Yes.
Yeah. So let me read this instructions first. So people who are participating on Zoom can understand how to participate and how to raise your hand and unmute your account. Just give me one moment, let me reshare my screen, then I'll read the instructions for public participation.
Deborah, you can fill out.
Okay. And okay, so for the committee representative Beverly, we're now opening public comment session for item number one. And now for those attending this meeting in person, speaker forms are available on the rear table. Please provide me with your speaker slip immediately. For those on Zoom, please use the raise hand feature to raise your hand to speak on this agenda item. For those joining by phone, please press star 9 to indicate your desire to speak. Please provide your speaker form, raise your hand or press star 9 or device immediately. And now late speaker forms will not be accepted. When you hear your name or last 4 digits of your phone number called, I'll prompt you to come up to the front or unmute your account and then inform you that you may begin speaking. I'll then ask you to state your name for the record. For those joining by phone, pressing star 6 will mute or unmute your microphone. As mentioned earlier in this meeting, please limit your speech to 3 minutes or less, which will be strictly enforced. And you will be respectfully asked to stop speaking after 3 minutes. We have a speaker form.
They're back there. Deborah spoke already.
Now we have a raised hand, so I will call this member of the public. Is Nan Hoglund?
Okay. Can you hear me now?
Yeah.
Thank you. My name's Nancy Hoagland. I live next door at 115 Seacliff Court. So I am very directly impacted by this project. A lot of it looks really good. I have been in some communication with the owners, but not a lot. These are the most detailed drawings I've seen. And I do have a couple of questions.
Okay. Did we lose you? Nancy, we cannot hear you. Are you muted?
Okay. Now can you hear me?
Yes. So we got
okay, sorry about that. Anyway, sorry. I'm not sure where you lost me. I live next door at 115 Seacliff Court. My property directly abuts the existing property. So close that there is absolutely no easement. The wall of my courtyard is the wall of the existing building. So I'm curious about how that removal of that will be handled. And there's also a cement wall that snakes around between our two properties that was put up by a previous property owner on their property. And I'm wondering how that will be handled. I'm happy to see that most of the trees that are going to be removed are not between me and the highway. They're on the other side of the property. That's great. So my question about the wall, the height of the proposed building, is that similar to the height of the existing, we call it the bridge that goes out towards the ocean? Or is it taller or shorter? And my biggest question is, how does this affect the water main that serves three properties that comes off of Seacliff Court, goes through my driveway, has made it problematical for me to build a garage, goes through their property and serves the other property on the point? Because it looks to me like this new proposed building, which is gorgeous, will sit directly on top of the water main.
Can you ask that last question one more time, please?
I'm curious how this will affect the existing water main, which goes through my driveway. I have a public utilities easement on my deed, it goes through their property and then also serves the third property on the point right before the state beach. I'm hoping it will mean the water main gets moved because it's a problem for everybody. It's a problem for the water department. It's been repaired dozens and dozens and dozens of times. It's old. But that was my last question. Thank you very much.
Thank
you. It looks gorgeous, by the way.
Right. Okay, since it's fresh in our minds, there is one more comment after this. Kanawha, let's work our way backwards. Do you have any response at this time as the planner to Nancy's third question about the water lines?
I would direct that to the project lead. He knows all of the connections. I don't think that I received any requests from the sewer water agencies for any upgrades. That wasn't part of the comments that we received, but and I think they can connect directly to the sewer and water mains. I don't think they were going to upgrade them, but to be sure, I'd ask the Sean.
Yeah, the sewer is on the ocean side of the property. The water main is on the highway side of the property.
Yeah, but I think that the sewer line will be upgraded as required, and that shouldn't be affected by our development. I think the water main on the Rio Highway side, there's some uncertainty as to what properties it actually serves. I think on some of the old parcel maps, it does show that easement running through our property and the neighboring property to the right behind the home. But it sounds like the property to the right no longer is served by a water main from that line. So at some point, their water line may have been abandoned to the third property. So there's some uncertainty as to where that lies for their property. So again, we take no issue into relocating water line serving our property if that can be done by Montero Water. But there have been no public or no formal comments, so we have not reacted to that at this time.
Can you show us on the site plan where that is? Nancy? I suggest that you write this in the question in the form of a letter. This is beyond our purview here, but I wanted to respect the question because it's important. I suggest you write a letter to the project planner, CCing the project architect, and it sounds like this is an issue that will be addressed over time, emphasizing again, it's beyond our purview, but I'm compassionate about your question. Does that sound like it's okay with you to do that?
Yes, that's fine. I just need to get the contact information for those two people.
Okay.
And I'm not trying to throw a monkey wrench into this or anything like that. It may solve a bunch of problems if we can figure out what's going on with this water main.
Yeah, Nancy, this is Sean Loves. I think we spoke on the phone last year. So yeah, we're open to keeping communication as we move forward through this process, especially once we get to the construction phase, where I think this will be more readily addressed once we get out there and actually survey where the water main lengths come from our property, the neighboring property, and we can address that at that time.
Right, and the contact information is on the Coast CDRC website, where these drawings come from, the coastal.
Okay, I've got Kanoa's email right here.
That's great. Okay, you're on the road. The other two questions. The proposed project height is 22 feet. The existing height is 27 feet, so it'll be 5 feet lower. Additionally, the building that is right up against the property line at the moment will comply with required setbacks. So the setback from that wall, that building won't start until 10 feet to the north, further away from your home, 10 feet. And that is the required proposed setback. Do you understand that?
Yes, I do. Thank you.
You're welcome. Okay. All right. So I think that answers your three questions.
I think so.
Yes.
Thank you very much.
You're welcome. Thank you. Okay, Mark Steckmeyer as a member of the public.
Well, I was going to spring off of her question. Now I can't remember the rest of it. But are you replacing the wall between Queen Martha and this house? The house to the left.
Replacing the wall?
That wall, yeah. You can replace that wall?
The wall that is not, that can be kept as is, that doesn't touch the building, will be kept for discussion with the planning staff, because I believe that it's an existing non-conforming height. So to protect the privacy of the neighbor, we'd like to keep it as is. But there is a portion that is shared between the building, the current structure. And again, that's something that during the construction phase will need to be explored to a greater extent as they kind of share. Well, we're going to check to get into their yard to really see what's going on, how the buildings are connected.
I don't remember. I think it was stalling. I worked on the house to the left and the house to the right in the past years. Keith and Martha did the full remodel, and then the other one on that side was almost traded for it.
So this is Mark Stegmar, who's the alternate long-term rep and the chair of CDRC, speaking as a member of the public.
And that's all that.
Anything else? Because you jumped out of your chair and you wanted to speak. You want to say about that?
I had a couple of questions, but
can you do that as a member of the public? Just state your name and where you live.
Okay. Mark Dinn.
I don't need to stay active. That's my change. You don't need to stay your private information, just your
area.
Just your name. Yeah, or general area of your residence.
Thank you.
So two questions. Mark Dinn, two questions. I pulled up the case study report, and it looked like it's a representative Ketchum.
Lisa
Ketchum had a question just really about the lateral walk access to the road. So it sounded like, I think I see her on the Zoom meeting, but it sounded like she was potentially going to bring that up. But I honestly don't understand requirements around that, besides, you know, the checks and things people like.
It's a sensitive habitat, and a lot of that sensitivity is due to the bluff. So that's one of the reasons why environmental negative deck is required.
So that will be addressed through
that air will, based on professional report recommendations, and come up with mitigation.
And the second thing is that there's the six trees being removed. I think they're all cypress, I'm not totally sure, but to just stand there. And I was just curious about why replacement trees aren't required based on the zoning requirements. So that may not be completely in the purview.
Apparently, it's not under our purview, but four are diseased and dead. So they're being removed for safety issues, not for strictly development issues.
Yeah, and also we have some permit exemptions for severely diseased trees, for dead trees. And now, can Noah may elaborate more on this topic?
Noah, can you say more about the trees being removed?
Yeah, what was the question? I couldn't hear.
Trees are being removed, but only two replaced. What is the policy on that?
If they're alive and they're in okay health, and they need to be replaced, and they need permits to remove them if they are dead. Dead trees don't need any permits to remove. They just have to notify us, and if send us some pictures. They had an arborist report that documented these trees, that our arborist reviews. And if he agrees, then they can remove them and they don't need any, it doesn't have to be part of a permit, and they don't have to replace them.
The section 65.21 says that the replacement of lost trees when required should be in a manner prescribed by the design review committee or design administrator, but shall not exceed the following specification. So it talks about the loss of significant indigenous trees and not necessarily why some of this diseased or not. It seems like that portion sounds like it's under the purview of the design review.
Yeah, certainly. If the design review company finds a need for additional replacement trees, that the design review company may condition that or provide common requirement based on this section.
So, okay. Yeah. It's just, when you pull it up in Google Maps.
Would you read that one more time, that section?
The replacement of lost trees when required by a manner prescribed by this site. Or it shall be in a manner prescribed by the design review committee or design review administrator, but shall not exceed the following specifications. And so that talks about replacing lost tree with real trees of the same species. So there's some detailed requirements there. It just seems like on that stretch, those trees are there's one that's on the highway side, but the others appear to be, between the neighbors. So they're heritage trees.
Interesting. I did go to the site just before coming here, and I specifically was looking at the trees. In addition to the trees, this is just my opinion, by the way. In addition to the trees, there's a lot of foliage. If you look at the landscape plan, just to the west of the highway. So it's fairly dense. The foliage is fairly dense on this property. It's almost a relief, and I like a natural setting personally. It's almost a relief to have these trees that are marked, particularly if they're diseased or dead, being removed. And that the two healthy ones, fortunately, are kind of at the furthest points from the house, because there are other trees that remain, that exist there. And it's quite dense with trees and foliage. So I'm not inclined to require three for one, or even two for one, or even one for one in this case, to protect what's being built and the other trees that are going to remain. I don't know, did you go over there, anyone?
Sorry to interrupt.
Yeah.
So we are currently in the public comment session right now.
We
so
are.
We have one more speaker.
We do.
So we
okay,
can.
I'll save it.
Yeah,
then.
We can save it for the discussion.
Yeah.
And the next speaker on the list is Deborah Robbins.
Nice.
You spoke already?
Okay.
Sounds good. And Beverly, please indicate if you'd like to close the
call. Sure. Let's
and we
close.
Have no more raised hands.
Oh, we do have more?
We do not have any other raised hands.
We can close and maybe continue that pre-conversation.
Yeah, then we can go into discussion session.
Thank you.
I agree with you, Beverly. I think that those trees are just excluded because of the health. It seems to me like a pretty well developed landscape plan, so I don't think we require anything additional.
Right.
As long as the neighbor who spoke earlier just seems that she was satisfied with the privacy that was being maintained by the trees that are staying. So I think that's the important issue.
Yeah, I think she stated she liked that was preserving.
Yeah.
Right. Certainly no more trees in that part of the property. In your work, I would urge you to consider trees to help the condition of the erosion where it may exist. And it could be that sort of a trade. you know, sort of in the context of that sort of area.
Yeah, yeah. I mean, we have a fantasy park tech on board, Bernard Trainer, and he has extensive knowledge and case studies for coastal coastal planting. So I think that our goal is to again create a irrigation-less property. So again, we'll definitely dive into our planting specifics there to, you know, increase stabilization of the slope topography there, while also maintaining, you know, the irrigation-less design.
Right. Preferably that would be coming across now. So what we see is kind of what you ultimately get. So any exceptions would go background through planning.
Yeah, I mean, I think that what we're showing is
what you're
planning, what we're planning on. Yeah.
We have five different ground covers here. I'm not familiar with all of them, but the Archistophilus. I think that we'll put some notes about erosion stabilizing ground cover recommendations.
Good idea.
But I know it's having landscape architect.
Yeah, right. Although you have that interest.
Yeah, I feel good about the findings that I do see represented here. Okay, discussion. This is a beautiful structure, and it's a great example of why we are in the process of rewriting the guidelines to be friendlier to flood roofs. There's language in the guidelines not supporting structures which are 100% flat roofs, but in the, since I've been on the committee, we've been routinely bending rules for stylistically consistent
architectural
projects that utilize more flat roof than the guidelines strictly call for. And I think that the structure, despite being all flat roofs, is really nicely articulated through these materials and the jogs and heights and clear story fans.
In the water genre.
Yeah, I think it's a beautiful project and I'm happy to have it in the community.
Short and sweet. What do you think, Beverly? I'm thrilled with this project, the materials, the composition. I have one big concern, and that is for the south neighbor on the south side. We have a priority in our standards, I'm sure you read this, for articulation. And the articulation on all other sides completely satisfies our requirement, except for this side. And part of what's contributing to it is the homogeneity of the materials along that.
Is this page 23, sheet A4.2?
That's correct.
A4.2, you're looking at.
That's correct. The materials and the configuration and the accentuated single line, single height. Any suggestions thoughts from the architect?
Well, I guess I would respond to that by saying that the articulation is three-dimensional because there are two panels, almost like garage doors. Essentially, those are not. They're deep recesses in that entire side of the building. And
Those two. The deep recess.
Here.
Yes. So, no. I see that, but I don't see how to interpret them as
the roof. Deep the roof. Recesses. If you go up one page, the
open
roof
to courtyard
next
below.
Page up.
So if you go to the plan, you can see.
It's a courtyard.
They're deep notches in the building.
And are the south neighbors looking into that courtyard, or is that a blind courtyard for them?
Yeah, so the louvered system that he's talking about is what provides privacy for the neighbors from the interior courtyards.
Mm-hmm.
So we're saying that
the color, material, the warmth of maybe the wood there on the louvers differentiates itself from the Neolith stone.
Yeah, panels. Certainly that's one way to do it. It's still on the same plane and goes to the same height on that side. And the rest is all same material, same height as, you know, the second material.
And there is a third material on base, right? This is where we have this, and this is the millet over
concrete.
Yeah.
And then what's the delineation like between those two materials? Are they just in plane? Is one step back from the other?
Shadow lines, open joints.
So reveal.
So there's an overall texture.
First of all, do you have an issue at all with that?
I mean, I hear what you're saying. It is definitely the kind of thing we talk about a lot. I think because the style, the modern style of this structure, it's really consistent, and using a reveal or something instead of a step feels appropriate to that. I think that having the three different materials plus the clear story band, I don't have a concern about it. I mean, we can talk about whether those wood panels would want to be recessed, if that would be something that would make you more comfortable, but
I think that would actually, I understand there's a slight reveal around the wood panels if they were stepped in a little bit, 2 feet. That would give us most definitely that articulation. How big is that courtyard?
Yeah. You got a page
13 and 14.
Is that a, it looks like the row up itself is almost 2 feet. Is
well,
the first courtyard off the living room, is that a grill on a counter that's on that?
Yes,
mm-hmm.
The barbecue courtyard
mm-hmm.
there off the living study. So,
Floor plan,
yeah, A21.
Yeah.
So it's probably.
And then in the second one between the
yeah.
family rooms, stage 21.
Right there, yeah, you can see them there, the two courtyards.
It's 13 feet wide.
Yeah.
And what are
right
the
here.
Six squares that we see in the plan?
Those are skylights
down
to
the space below.
To the space
uh-huh.
below. The
so
below.
Is that courtyard accessible, or that's just really a light well?
The light well.
Uh-huh.
Yes, the one on the left is the light well, the one on the right is
mm-hmm.
will be accessible through sliding. Mm-hmm.
We're giving some consideration to making the second one accessible as well,
mm-hmm.
so that we can fill in between the two.
Mm-hmm.
The only thing, if it is set back, it will kind of impact the aesthetics of the house from the interior.
Yeah,
mm-hmm.
yeah. 2 feet is more than I think 2 feet would impact those spaces.
The only other thing I would say in reference to the neighbors that are already afforded 10 foot
setback
on the fence.
I think Beverly's concern is just about the flat plane of the wall, just because of the guideline around articulation. I mean, to my mind, the three materials, and it's true that this is the one side where we don't have a change in height visible from the edge.
Well, I think the fact that it will be slats and louvers, the overall
mm-hmm.
texture of those panels. I mean, we could look at possibly putting them slightly out of plane with each other.
Mm-hmm.
2 feet, I think, takes too much out of the courtyard. Starts to impact my client's life. But I don't want to do that. But, and I don't want...
What
I
would you
I don't
be
want,
looking at?
Pardon?
What would you consider?
I don't know. I don't want to contribute to the design of the panel.
What
I'm thinking,
mm-hmm.
we would have to explore this. What I'm thinking is, would it be possible to even have those be pushed out from that plane rather than set in?
Mm-hmm.
And we are on the setback line, however, it's an individual element.
Yeah, blaze and architectural windows would be permitted to project up to. What?
Which elements?
These are louvered elements.
They're on ground. If it's on ground,
this one's not on ground. It's not. This one's a little above. No, those don't come all the way to the ground. And I think that even if they were,
is that ground?
No, that's the. This is ground.
Most of this is.
I mean, I think if those came in or projected out even 4 or 6 inches, that would be a shadow line and the numbers that
how wide can be projected out? Is it 4 feet?
You mean, are you talking about the exemption?
Yeah, the exemption is where
Section 64.06, I remember it's 3 feet, but I need to confirm that.
The width
so,
of the that's permitted?
Yeah, can you go to, so 0. Let's go to 64.06.
Okay. And while you're doing that, can I also ask, the louvers, are those also behind the cabinetry with the grill? Or?
Correct, yeah.
Okay.
How high is this?
So the
You got
it. It butts into the existing wall.
Yeah.
It's just
10 feet.
7 or 8.
2 feet with the mechanism.
Sure. So that's
first
one sort of
the
old
secured by the
fence. But is there a limit on how wide they can be from the ground? No, because
they're from the floor line. They're full line.
Okay. So these projections, there's no limit on the width. So those louver.
These start at ground.
At floor line.
At the floor line, not
floor
the grade
line.
Yeah,
floor line.
Yeah. So my way of addressing
this lower floor.
Yeah. I think I think that the suggestion that those push in or out doesn't have to be prescriptive to give them the option to explore it. I think they could go in or out to the extent permitted by the Section 64.
Yeah, I just want to confirm
yeah.
what kind of architectural we're talking about right now. Is it like a kind of like a bump out, like architectural?
Yeah, like a bay window.
Like
it's
a bay window?
It's like a bay window.
Okay.
Although I
so
would, I
we
mean,
have a bay window handout here, so let me just put it out. So it's a clarification that the management staff made.
Is there a limit on the width that these can be?
I'll open the handout. There's a paragraph there, so they'll help people understand like what they know.
When you say this is a louver, does it louver or does it roll?
There's
stage fixed,
yeah. So a slat wall with.
Are they flat or are they angled?
They haven't been detailed.
Okay,
they're currently shown.
It will depend on how light comes through. What you see looking into from the neighbor, what you see looking out. And from the neighbor, you won't really be looking in because of the height of the wall.
Mm-hmm. What's the distance from finished floors to ground?
Along the front corridor.
No, just under the louvers.
Yeah, so at the front courtyard where the barbecue is, it's about a foot out of the ground, and then along the rear courtyard where the skylights are. That's again with the slope of the ground there, you're even further out of the ground. Existing grade at the neighbor's side, 3 to 4 feet.
Okay. 3 to 4 feet. And what's the distance it has to be off grade, off finished grade, in order to be allowed to bump out?
From finished grade?
Did you just have a document?
Yeah, I just had a document open. If we're talking about bay window, the encroachment is 2 feet. We're about 2 feet under section 64.06. Since the project planner Kenoa is on the side, if Kenoa disagree, please feel free to chime in. But according to the handout, if they're really proposing a bay window and that bay window meets the definition of the handout, then now they can encroach into the setback line by 2 feet.
And how high off the ground does it have to be?
It doesn't really speak to
not touch grade. But I think that there's also an exception for architectural features, which wouldn't be limited to the definition of the bay window. I would think that we could develop some language around the louver panels being projecting or recessed up to the amount allowed by zoning exemptions
and
to
maximum.
Create some articulation on the facade.
What is your gut feeling for what you would not want to do? Would you be okay, for example, with 12 inches, a foot bump out or recessed?
Sure. I mean, I think if you're going inboard, it'd be less than, it'd be that into that 4 to 6 inch realm in order to not affect that barbecue courtyard.
I think in or out probably goes too far, but that's what I'd rather leave the language open and not to let them.
Well, we don't want a minimum, we don't want it to be 2 inches. We don't want it to be 3 inches.
You want to say between 4 and 24 inches. You want more?
Say between
six and 24.
And yeah, not because I think 24 is the limit. 6 and 24. Do we establish that the setback is minimum for the sides, or is it 5 feet minimum? Because I think it's 5 feet minimum. It's 5 feet just for
I see the zone regulations that Kenoa must be more familiar with it. So Kenoa, can you please respond to these questions?
Sorry, can you repeat the question?
Are there elevations for the building above 18 feet? If you have them. Sorry to put you on the spot, but if not, it seems like you can get to 5 feet on the side setback.
Come out into the setback by as much as 5 feet.
Well, the side setback of the building is 18 feet or higher. It's going to be combined 15 feet. We have 5 feet on the north side and then 10 feet on the south side. But if you're 18 feet or less, you can just have 5 and 5.
What's the height of your structure?
Depending on where you are on the property, it varies, right?
From finished grades.
No, we'll just look at any point. Just look at any point of the structure.
I'm looking at it. I see a lot of 11, but I don't know if that's true.
If any point sees the threshold, then we will apply the stricter setback,
which is 2 feet.
We'll talk about different. So this is the residential structural setback.
Yeah.
And the 2 feet is the exception.
If our entire building was under 18 feet, we'd have a 5 and 5. Yeah. But because the extension beyond the slope of the water is 22, now we're combined.
10 plus 5. Yeah. Okay. So they're choosing to do it 10 and 5.
Yes, we are now.
So just back to the articulation.
Mm-hmm.
Jim, I want to know that we respect the design and appreciate it. And it's a section in our rule book, which I think you've read as well, that requires every facade to express with articulation, and you have choices for how to do that. So what we're suggesting with the push or pull, I think it sounds fine.
Okay.
Yeah, it worked for me.
Okay. And I think usually what happens is so Beverly will write up sort of the notes, and then all of you can look at them back and forth and develop language to try and give you flexibility, but that will be the condition of approval, would be creating some facade articulation on the south elevation.
Yes.
By modifying the louver panels to go inboard or outboard 6 to 24 inches, and then just to let them realize the time. Is there anything else?
Yeah, so just want to say one thing. I agree with what Rebecca just said. So it's kind of hard to visualize like what you need to do to address that comment. So just please offer some flexibility and do something like within the limit of the zone regulations, just in case the requirement is not consistent with the zone regulations.
Right.
There's a conflict that may require the project to come back to CRC. So please offer some flexibility if the CRC can.
I think we will. I think then the worst case scenario would be the back of the lens, essentially.
Yeah.
Did you have any other concerns?
No, I'm just
wearing his notes.
Everything.
Okay. So you
no,
said
that's
make a motion?
Permit.
Yeah. And I make a motion to approve the project with one condition that we outlined.
So we have one condition for articulation. We have just a clarification, all lighting dark sky compliant, and a clarification, all glass glazed for bird sensitivity.
Okay, I'll do a roll call. Rebecca Kecken?
Yes.
Barry Garrity?
Yes.
Okay, recommendation, it's a recommendation and has been, the motion has been passed. And so for next step, please work with your project planner, Kanawha County.
So we've recommended approval.
Yeah.
Thank you. Congratulations. Thank you. Welcome to the neighborhood.
Yeah.
So beautiful.
Yeah.
Does someone want to make a motion to adjourn the meeting?
Okay.
Are we
having a motion, you guys?
Thanks a lot.
Sir, second.
Good work.
Second.
Thank you so much. Thank you,
Retire. You're welcome.
Welcome.
Thank you. Very
yeah.
This is a project.
Yeah.
Capital figure out that vote.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay. And now we need to do a roll call. So formally adjourn this meeting. Mark Stagmeyer?
Yes.
Rebecca Peckin?
Aye.
Barry Garrity?
Aye.
Mark Dean?
Aye.
Okay, meeting adjourned. Thank you, everyone.
Yay.
Well done.
Well done.
Congratulations.
The comment by Lisa Ketchum is very interesting.
I didn't see it.
It's in the case report.
This is what's right.
So they're building.
Oh, that's the bridge they were talking about.